I'm happy to introduce our esteemed panelists for this discussion, which hopefully will be just as lively and fun as if we were all together in person. David Autor from MIT, Eric Hirst from University of Chicago, Ahu Yildirmaz from the ADP Research Institute, and Mark Zandi from Moody's Analytics, all some of the foremost experts we've got on the labor market. And as I said, it's a hot topic for us on CNBC, especially today, where we just got more news that another 1.48 million Americans filed for unemployment benefits. So I'd like to kick it off, Mark, with you by asking, what do we expect with employment going forward? And how long is it going to take to make up and bring back all of those jobs lost in March and April?
Thanks, Sarah. It's good to be with you. And Ahu, thanks for the invitation to participate on the panel. And of course, thank you to ADP for sponsoring all this and providing all the valuable information and resources that you do. You can see just how important your data is to the research around this crisis. Well, to your question, I think this is, it's going to be a while before we get these jobs back. I think over the next several months, we'll get about half the jobs lost back. We lost, just to be more precise, 22 million jobs peak to trough. We'll get roughly 10, 11, 12 million back by Labor Day. And then I think we the remaining 10, 11, 12 million jobs, that'll be tougher to get back and probably won't happen until after the other side of the pandemic, when we have a vaccine or a therapy that's widely distributed and adopted. Obviously that's impossible to know, but it's not until after that that we get those jobs back. And that's largely because of the ongoing social distance. Even if we don't have a reintensification of the virus that disrupts businesses again in a significant way, which is a big F, obviously, given what's going on. But even if that doesn't happen, the social distancing rules that are in place in many areas of the country that will remain in place throughout the pandemic mean that businesses that have been highly disrupted just won't really get back up to full speed. There are the obvious ones, recreational activities, accommodation, travel, airlines, transportation, retailing, all those businesses won't get back up to full speed. So I think it's going to be a bit of a slog here to get back up to get all those jobs back. And it won't be for at least three years before we're back to anything we feel pretty comfortable about.
Eric, I saw you quoted in the Wall Street Journal recently, and the quote was, "The magnitude and speed of this employment loss is like nothing we've ever seen before." So if we've never seen anything like this, how do you even put a forecast on how long it will take to return?
Yeah, I want to say two things kind of related around that, around the theme. You know, most recessions usually start with some imbalance in the economy to begin with. Maybe we lent too much to subprime borrowers, or inflation was too high, or there was a dot-com bubble. And the normally what happens in a recession is then we adjust to that kind of misalignment in the economy through the recession. That is not this recession. So this recession, we know exactly what caused it, and we know exactly what will cure it, as Mark said. It is a health shock. And so what has happened is, when you're thinking about it from ourselves when we're modeling, you have to think through the lens of a health model, which means it's not like other things we've seen before. And so in those first month and a half after, the start of March or mid-March, as Mark said, we lost 22 million jobs. But just in perspective, that's like one-fifth of the U.S. labor market sat idle. That is historically large. And even if, as Mark, Mark and I don't always agree on much sometimes, but this we agree on completely. Even if we get 10 million jobs back this summer, that'd be historic growth by any sort of labor market in over a three-month period. To get 10 million net jobs added, we'll still be down 12 million jobs come Labor Day. And to put that in perspective, we lost about 7 million jobs during the Great Recession. So it's still twice as big as the Great Recession after that. So that's kind of the size of the shock. Because it was so large to begin with, then the contraction, we have such a long way to go. We could have huge contractions, huge expansions, historic expansions, and still be, 12 million jobs or something like, 8 or 9% lower employment than we started with in early March. And then the reason, and I don't want to re-echo what Mark said, but I agree 100% in the sense that this will keep going until the public health crisis is cured. And so that comes with vaccine or death mitigation or herd immunity or something that basically makes people feel safe again. And that is uncertain. And us as economists and us as policymakers aren't public health officials, but that is when the labor market will go back to normal.
You're all supposed to be epidemiologists now, not just economists. David, I wanted to get your thoughts as well.
I've never talked more about on the I not than I have in my life before this time.
Well, by the way, journalists too are supposed to be epidemiologists now. David, right. Your thoughts on the view forward as we look at the historic nature of the size and scale of this loss of jobs in this country.
Sure. Thanks, Eric. So I want to agree with what Eric just said. I agree that we know exactly what caused it, but I don't think we know what will cure it. And by that, I mean that curing the disease will not return us to where we were before for two types of reasons. One is that we will have a lot of businesses permanently bankrupted. They will not unbankrupt. And the other is that I think we're going to see sectoral shifts that are going to change the composition of demand, change the composition of consumption, having to do potentially reduced business commuting, reduced going to offices, perhaps even reduced demand for cities, and also with reductions in business travel and business and hospitality. So I don't think even if this were cured tomorrow, the point where we were bound to is not where we would have been. And if that's true, and maybe that's incorrect, but to the degree that there is a lot more sectoral reallocation that has to happen, that makes it a slower recovery because we're not just going back into our positions in our previous places.
Anyone want to take the other side? I like the disagreement.
I think there is one part of that, which is, it's not so much a disagreement. I think David said it is an uncertainty. A lot of in recessions in general, there is what I call institutional capital that sometimes gets destroyed. And so what is the institutional capital is that workers get located from their match, they get fired from their firm, and then those firms might have to find another worker, and that takes time. Or the firms themselves go away, and new firms have to come in. And that we know as economists how to deal with, because that happens a lot in a lot of recessions. And so when we start thinking about policies that you're seeing now, a lot of it is to try to preserve that institutional capital. The second part of that is how different are things going to be when they come out? We could talk about that. So there's certainly uncertainty about how different things might be. But a lot of, the big losses are going to be in things like entertainment sectors, broadly defined, social sectors. Restaurants and bowling alleys and movie theaters. And these are things that we enjoy. And so a lot of those I expect are going to come back fully once we get vaccine. David pointed out about will there be changes in convention, travel, business travel. David and I travel a lot for our jobs. And there is production aspects of that. And then there's also consumption aspects of that. And some of those are, done better in person than they are abroad. So I don't think we're going to see as much of the business travel decline as we did before. We'll see some. The fact that, David invites me to give a talk at MIT, and sometimes I'm tired, and I might Zoom in for the day, and that might slow things down. But I also like going to dinner with David, and at some other point when we're at dinner, we come up with new papers. So I don't know if it'll decline quite as much as he does. But that is where I think the uncertainty will come. As we come out of this. I mean, I also have other uncertainties about the speed of the recovery we could talk about later on. But I just don't, I'll see some of it. I think the first order thing is preserving the institutional capital, but that happens in every recession about the matches of firms and bringing firms back.
Sarah, can I make a quick point?
Yeah, we'll get please.
Yeah, not a point of disagreement, although I do disagree about travel. It will be significantly impaired, just judging by my travel budget, which is very significant globally. I have 200 economists across the globe that work for me, and we are not going back to the kind of travel that we had before ever happening. So this is a very big deal in terms of business travel. But the point I want to make is a cautionary one, and that is hiring has clearly picked up as businesses have reopened. But what is so surprising to me and disconcerting is that layoffs remain extraordinarily high. I mean, you mentioned the UI number this morning, 1.5 million. I don't know what it was for the pandemic, the extra UI claims for the expanded UI. So we're probably close to 2 million in initial claims. Just for context, in a good typical economy, it should be somewhere a tenth of that, a couple hundred thousand per week. And we run a survey at Moody's weekly of global businesses, and we ask a lot of questions. One's around hiring and layoffs, and hiring has picked up. Businesses say they are hiring at a much higher rate than just a few weeks ago. But the percent of businesses that are laying off also remains extraordinarily high. And that is very surprising to me. So if we don't see initial claims come in and layoffs begin to abate more quickly, then expectations of getting half those jobs back by Labor Day are going to be more difficult to achieve.
So, but David's conjecture of spectral shifts would exactly predict that. So part of what we think when we think about reallocation is some things are going to have to go away. They didn't think they would have in April, but it's coming to May and people are getting things. And so these sectoral shifts is, you know, we're seeing lots of churn. Lots of firms hiring, lots of firms firing. The net is hiring. We're seeing employment go up by about 7 million jobs over the last month. But the churn is something symptomatic of kind of what David said. We might be seeing some of this reallocation.
Well, just this morning, Macy's announced a few thousand job cuts in their corporate headquarters. So I think it's a good example of an industry that is facing some secular decline and sort of rolling job losses. Ahu, I want to get you in here and on your work specifically on where the losses are and how it mingles with inequality in this country, which is such a front and center issue right now anyway. But just thinking about how you're seeing the breakdown in terms of wage disparities and gender disparities across the job losses we've seen in this pandemic.
Thank you, Sarah. Inequality actually is the nickname of this recession. We have never seen such magnitude of divergence across different types of workers. Eric once told me, we were talking, and low-wage workers experienced their own Great Depression during this crisis, and that's what the data also show. We actually, in our research, and John and Thomas presented early in the morning, we show that low-wage workers experience the almost 37% employment declines, and this is the group. Those people who make less than $15. And this is early March, end of April. Then when we look at the high earners making more than $32, this compares to 10% decline. So in terms of the hit, the employment declines, the bottom low-wage workers got really much bigger hit. But also, even past few weeks when we started seeing the jobs coming back, we continued to see to observe the inequality. And by late May, the low-wage workers, those at the bottom, were still depressed by 30% in terms of the employment decline, but the top earners actually remained 5%. So the fact that bottom is impacted more is not surprising because it's usual, that's what we see in the recessions, but the magnitude of the difference is historic. And I want to mention one more thing. Women, again, also continue to get their fair share from the inequality during this crisis. By late April, the employment declines was around 3 to 4 percentage points larger for women. It was around 22%, whereas the employment declines for men was around 18%. Again, historically, we could have explained this by sector, because usually manufacturing, which is male-dominant industry, gets usually the biggest hit during the recessions. But it wasn't the case this time, because we normalized this comparison by sector. So something else is happening, and I think we speculate, we think that this has something to do with childcare. We will definitely explore that with more with a household survey, but gender again showed in terms of the disparity during this recession.
Eric, what happens to those low-wage jobs when they get rehired as the economy comes back? What happens to wages?
So the wage part of it. There's too many margins of labor market adjustment when firms are faced with shocks. One is shedding workers, and we've talked a lot about the shedding of the workers, the unprecedented amount of shedding a worker. Firms could also then adjust on the price they pay workers, so the wages. And, you know, wages tend in most periods of time not to go down, in the sense that you don't see a lot of what we call nominal wage cuts. Your wage gets slashed by your firm in most periods of time. In the last 3 months or so, you're seeing a large amount of, we'll call it wage adjustment, if you will, could be earnings adjustment, where firms are cutting the wages of workers or sometimes furloughing a worker. So basically saying, just don't come in today and we're not going to pay you today for salaried workers. And so you see about 10% of workers are getting these nominal wage declines in the last few months. And then we could also look, using the strength of the ADP data, at firms that usually adjust their wages March, April, May. Most firms adjust most of the workers' wages in 1 month during the year. At the University of Chicago, July 1 is our annual wage adjustment. And it's that way all the time. And so then we can look at those firms that normally adjust wages in March, April, and May, and see what they're doing to their regularly scheduled wage increases for their workers. And you're seeing a lot fewer wage increases relative to what you've seen in the past. So you got these two dimensions of adjustment of wages going on. They're actually literally cutting wages for some firms, but lots of firms aren't giving wage increases as well. So, you know, it's a way that, you know, there's some decrease in the demand for labor in many sectors. Firms don't want the workers anymore because workers might, you know, the consumers might not want their products. They don't want to go to restaurants. They don't want to go to vacations or airlines or business travel. And when you're seeing that, you're seeing adjustments both on quantity and prices. And most of those wage cuts are at the top end of the distribution, where most of the job losses are at the bottom end of the distribution.
I think there's also evidence that...
Go ahead, Mark.
No, I was just going to say, I mean, I think there's... this is a big distinction between this crisis and the financial crisis, because in the financial crisis, the evidence suggests that businesses were very loath to cut nominal wages, that... I mean, if you look at the aggregate wage statistics, they, you know, got real wage growth down to zero, but they never went below that in aggregate. And if you look at the more disaggregated data, the wage cuts did pick up, but very modestly compared to what is happening now in the last few months. So I think this is another very disconcerting aspect of what we're going through right now, the fact that businesses are so shell-shocked and so worried about their own survival that they are now turning to nominal wage cuts. And that if that continues, that could be, you know, a particularly pernicious problem for the economy.
David, I just wanted to get your thoughts. Go for it.
Yeah, I mean, so this, you know, this pandemic comes after the, you know, the longest consistent expansion, employment expansion the U.S. economy has ever seen, I believe. And that expansion has huge benefits for low-wage workers. Tight labor markets are the thing that cause wage growth to grow in many of these in-person service occupations that are not credentialed, not specialized. They only start to see real wage increases when things get very tight. So I think there's two issues going forward. One, the general labor market is going to be slack for a while, meaning that in general, things that create wage pressure. And then at least my expectation is that those in-person service occupations will be particularly low in demand, not simply because of the looming threat of the virus, but even abstracting from that, again, that if there is a decline in business travel and hospitality travel, if people commute less to work, meaning they eat out less for lunch, they go out less for dinner, or at least maybe less for lunch, that those are going to cause an inward contraction of all this low-paid in-person service work. And our economy has a lot of job growth over the last 20 years has been driven by low-paid in-person service jobs. And the only thing worse than too many lousy jobs is too few lousy jobs, because it means that employers have to bid, don't have to bid as hard to get them. So I'm concerned about that potential change.
I am going to steal that quote, as I steal many things from you over time, but that is a fantastic line. I mean, it's a very powerful line, but it's fantastic.
Yeah.
I just want to introduce the relief and recovery that has come from Washington, which sort of distorts a little bit of these figures. Mark, how much is that extra unemployment bonus that runs through the end of July that the government is now giving to unemployed workers? How much of that is really creating a disincentive for them to come back to work? It's a common Republican talking point, and we've heard anecdotally from some businesses that it is really sort of competitive for them to bring workers back with the government stimulus. Is that really happening at a large scale? Is that holding workers from coming back?
I think that's an overstated argument. I mean, I'm sure there are anecdotes and cases where you can find people who aren't going back because they're getting much more on UI. But I don't think that's a macro economic event. Even if there were disincentives, there are the positives of that is it really helped the economy through the worst of this crisis when people were very scared, nervous. I mean, I think back to when this was put into place back in March and early April, we really didn't know much about the virus, how it was going to unfold and what it meant. So I think it made a lot of sense to err on the side of providing too much help than too little help. And it's actually, shown up in other statistics and data. I mean, credit problems have been much muted compared to what has been feared in terms of mortgage defaults and credit card delinquencies. There's other policies that have helped that, but it also goes to the income support that people are getting through UI. So I think the problem is overstated. Now, having said that, I do think we're past the worst of the blow from the pandemic, hopefully, unless the pandemic re-intensifies here in a significant way. But again, barring that scenario, we're past the worst of the pandemic, the supply side shock, the business shutdowns, the businesses are reopened. So I think at this point, it would make sense to scale back that extra benefit. So instead of the $600 a week, I think it makes much more sense to put it down to $300 a week. And that way, you would significantly reduce any concerns about disincentives and help the adjustment process as businesses reopen and job openings become more available. And then, you take stock of where we are later in the year, or maybe the end of the year. Let's say Congress and administration agree to a $300 benefit through the end of the year. Then at that point, you see where you stand and you could eliminate it altogether or, decide which way you want to go with it. But I think at this point, it makes sense to scale it back. But this argument that it's significantly impairing the ability of businesses to hire or people aren't going back, I think that's overstated. And you don't see it in the data. We got 2.5 million jobs back, and obviously reflects a lot of hiring going on in the month of May. We're probably going to have a similar number in the month of June. So the aggregate data isn't consistent with the idea that this is creating significant disincentive effects. The final thing I will say, though, is that there's a better way to do this. And, if I were king for the day, and I'll just throw it out and stop, is the Congress is also considering enhancing the employee retention tax credit. That's a much better way to provide support to businesses and workers, and it keeps them on payroll before letting them go on UI, and so then you don't have these kinds of disincentive effects to worry about.
Do you like that better than the rehiring bonus, which they're talking about?
Well, in my view, that's a solution looking for a problem. I mean, I don't think if you buy into my view that, you know, this isn't that big a deal, then no, I don't think that's where we should be focused on. I think we should be focused on trying to make it all work better. And if I were in Congress, I would focus on that employee retention tax credit. It solves lots of different problems, including the potential that you may be creating disincentive effects with the UI program.
I'm not sure the administration is going that way. Eric, what would you do? What do you think about Mark's proposal of down to 300 bonus, no bonus for rehiring? It sounds like the administration is talking about ending the extra bonus unemployment benefits and just talking about the bonus for rehiring, which to me would seem like a big income shock. But what do you think?
Yeah, so let's start with one, I think, fact from colleagues of David and I broadly defined. On the spending side of the measurement as opposed to the labor market side where David and I hang out. And so there's work now that shows what has happened to spending at different parts of the income distribution over the pandemic. And so kind of the stuff Ahu talked about earlier, we know from the labor market side, the employment effects were disproportionately concentrated at the bottom end of the distribution. And the people who look at spending effects find relatively similar spending declines in percentage changes for both rich and poor during this time period, high wage and low wage workers during this period. And if anything, the spending declines are a little bit more for the higher wage workers. And so you're saying, how does that work? Well, I think Mark already alluded to it. And your question was exactly that. There's been a huge amount of policies to prop up the incomes of people at the bottom of the distribution during the recession. $600 is a lot more in percentage terms to somebody with lower wages than it is with higher wages. And if we start stopping those programs when employment effects are so concentrated at the bottom end, you're going to start seeing massive declines in spending, massive declines in spending, and massive declines in well-being for people at the bottom of the wage distribution. And so that's something to keep in back in the mind. So some sort of policy we might need if the concentration of job losses are still going to remain at the bottom end of the distribution, as David and Ahu and Mark, all of us, kind of alluded to as we go through the next few months and maybe even longer than that. And so doing like a rehiring bonus as opposed to something else has some efficiency gains in some things. It doesn't provide the distortion on labor supply, but it also stops reallocation. If you're just bringing back the same workers, we might need workers to be reallocating in some sense. And a lot of these low-wage workers, there's a lot of churn to begin with anyways. So I just don't find the disincentive effects to be that large. Especially when the labor market's so weak and there's always workers to be found. So I think some policy, you know, might be necessary if we predict this to be as prolonged and the losses in the labor market concentrated at the bottom end.
Eric, I bet there's also gender differences when we look at that behavior, because I think moms, females, women will have less incentive and rather get the UI to stay home because of the childcare again.
What schools stay closed?
How do you have a normal return to work if schools can't open in the fall?
That's a big issue. I mean, I face that myself. My team faces that challenge themselves, and I think that's why we have seen that gap. When we look at the job gains past 2 weeks. Still, that gap widened in terms of women and men. Childcare is going to be a big problem. So it's a big issue. And I have to be honest, it's not only a female issue. It's also, I know a lot of dads also, men also, are doing a lot of work. but it is going to be a huge issue.
David, wanted to get your thoughts on the, you know, the unemployment benefits, but also maybe if you could touch on the PPP, which we haven't brought into this conversation, but whether that was effective in terms of retaining and bringing back workers, and whether more is going to need to be done on that front for small business.
Sure thing. A number of points. First of all, we should be impressed by how effective the CARES Act actually was. So there's a paper out this week by Ji-Hoon Han, Bruce Meyer, and James Sullivan out of the University of Chicago, Bruce Meyer, that says that poverty actually fell during the pandemic. And that is solely and entirely attributable to the CARES Act. The fact that we had the unemployment insurance increase, we had the PPP, we had these direct payments to households, that's remarkable. Many people think, oh, the federal government, it just can't be effective. Well, there's no other institution that could have just said, hey, let's take 5% of GDP and redistribute it to households and workers. And, you know, that was just, no foundation could have done that. No big business could have done that. And it worked. So that itself, we should step back and say, you know, I would have predicted that, but it is remarkable. So we often deride our institutions as ineffective. It turns out sometimes they're the only thing that can be effective. Second, I think there's evidence that both CARES and PPP had, or the CARES UI policy and the PPP policy both had real effects. So the talk that David Cho gave earlier very clearly showed, I think the evidence is pretty compelling, although it's still early, that PPP did cause about a 7 percentage point excess rebound in employment at small firms relative to larger firms. And that's a lot, that's several million jobs. So PPP seems to have hit the target, whether it was the most cost-effective way to do what it did, we don't know. Whether that's altogether good, maybe you don't want to keep all these firms going because they're not long-term viable, we don't know. But certainly it hit its target. The evidence that Brandon Enriquez presented on the UI extension suggests, and this is even more preliminary, that if you look across the manufacturing sector across states, that states that had more high-wage manufacturing had less, had excess separation than states that had low-wage manufacturing. You know, assuming that the state of demand is pretty similar across manufacturing, this suggests that, in fact, where the replacement rate was higher, you saw more separations of workers. And we think, you know, manufacturing was not, did not have to contract. It's consistent with the idea that the UI system did have create excess separations. We don't, again, we don't know how costly, right? Maybe, you know, that'll allow firms to restructure. Maybe that'll be productive. Maybe if they're those you know, pairings were valuable, workers will return. But clearly the policy, it seems that the policy did something. I think that, you know, all this money runs out in July. So even if you thought, oh, there are all these distortions being created, we don't have much longer to go before Congress has to act again. And if they don't, there'll be very serious consequences because we are still at 15% unemployment. And to cut off all these benefits would be really painful for many, many people. So in aggregate, I give Congress, you know, I rarely do this, but I'm going to give them a low A on this effort, given how little time they had to do their homework and how big an assignment it was.
In our 23 years of knowing each other, David's never given me higher than a C. So that is a very high grade from David.
But David, what do they need to do specifically to extend it?
Well, you know, I think that, the, you know, you have the, there's different ways to do it. And, you know, to Congress' credit, they had, you know, three options and they chose all of them, right? One was through employers or PPP. One was through the unemployment insurance system they expanded, and then one was sending money to households. And all of those reached different targets. I think it may be that we don't need to have as generous a UI top-up right now. You could calibrate that down, but then you could send another round of payments to households. It's also the case, by the way, most people don't realize this, but many states have what's called short-time work, meaning you can reduce your hours and have the UI system pay partial UI benefits, but currently you would still get the $600 if you did that. You would get the full top-up. Many people could actually have a higher replacement rate if they reduced their hours a little bit. And so, you know, it's possible that you could, you know, this could be used in a more calibrated fashion to benefit workers. Some of that is just the information is not out there. U.S. has had short time policy for a long time. It's very, very rarely used. So just to summarize, it would be if Congress lets us fall off a cliff in July, that's going to hurt a lot. That would be a bad cliff to fall from. So there needs to be some continuation policy. It doesn't need to be exactly the same policy, but it needs to be still pretty big. We are in a very, very serious employment hole right now.
Sarah, can I say a couple things in part of that first? Oh, sorry.
Go for it. No, go. Oh, so, and then we'll move on. Okay,
yeah. I mean, I couldn't agree more with David about the need for more fiscal support. I think if no further support is coming on the other side of Labor Day, even without a second wave, I think we go back to recession-like conditions. And with unemployment already near double digits or in double digits, I think that's the fodder for words like depression. So I don't Congress administration can go away before the August recess and not pass a substantive fiscal rescue package. The second thing I'd say is at the top of the list of the things they need to do, and they have not done yet in any meaningful way, and this is one area where they've not addressed, is what's going on in state and local government. The state and local governments are hemorrhaging red ink. And by our calculation, under our baseline forecast, the budget shortfall, even if they use all of their fiscal, all their rainy day fund money, will be close to $500 billion in the next two fiscal years, which starts on July 1. And if they don't get it, they're going to slash payrolls. I mean, that's where we're going to get the layoffs. I mean, state and local government already have laid off 1.5 million workers, and that's on a job base before all this started of about 20 million. So that gives you a sense of magnitude. These are middle-paying jobs. The average job pays $65K. These are teachers, police, fire, emergency responders, hospital workers. These are folks you need at any point in time, but certainly in a pandemic, it's beyond a reason to have these kinds of layoffs. So that is job number one for Congress and the administration. If they don't get that done, that is going to be a very serious problem for every community across the country in blue states and in red states.
I can't tell where they are on that, Mark. Are they getting it done? Does anyone think that this is happening urgently?
Yeah, I think of all the things that seems most likely. I mean, there's the only problem is Senate Republican support. Mitch McConnell, more specifically, is not supportive, or at least he's ostensibly not been supportive. But at the end of the day, we have an election coming. It'd be pretty surprising to me if we don't get a package that includes state and local government aid. If you look at anybody's forecast, and I'm sure the Fed's forecast, although they won't tell us, they are assuming something about fiscal policy. I think people are assuming that we are going to get that. So if we don't get that help, then I think forecasts are going to change quite a bit.
Ahu, I wanted to ask you if there's any way we can tell how much of the job losses are tied to business closures.
Ahu, I think you're on mute.
Ahu, are you there?
Sorry, they keep texting that I have to mute. So, okay. So, we did look at this in our research. What we did, we decomposed the employment declines and attributed to shutdowns, continuing firms, and reentry. So if you think about April 25th was the peak decline, which was around 21%, we found that almost 80% of this decline came from continuing firms. Shutdowns or exiting firms accounted for around 28 to 30% of the overall employment decline. I mean, it's not 100% because we have new firms entering. Then we also looked at post-April 25th, after April 25th until the end of May. We observed employment gains. We observed some employment gains. And almost one third of that increase due to reopening firms. About 70% of increase was due to net hiring in continuing firms. And these are actually, these are the workers, the recall of furloughed workers for continuing firms. So it's pretty high. So I think both reopening and workers returning their firms are both playing a major role. And this is the data that we are actually watching on a weekly basis.
Does it vary by city? Are you able to break it down by city and state?
Yes, we look at by state. And of course, the employment increases are much more associated with the states starting to reopening. And the other thing is you also see that the smaller firms actually coming back. But this is even more than the state, it's really sectoral impacts were there. I mean, we see a lot of leisure and hospitality as the states start opening their businesses, those sectors started coming back.
One thing
Eric,
I just
how do you
like
think about quickly, it? Oh, yeah, go ahead, David.
Something to bear in mind is we're speaking, as actually one of our audience members, Julia Coronado, reminds us, as if the pandemic is now fading out. But it's not clear that that's actually occurring. In many ways, the U.S. seems to have sort of given up on managing this problem. And we are now seeing resurgence in or growth in many places where it was not occurring. I mean, we are in good company with Brazil and Russia as countries that are now seeing huge spikes and may not be allowed into Europe. If we continue on this trajectory, we're going to need a lot more help, both medical and financial.
Yeah. Actually, Texas, I think just today's slowing down the opening. So this may all change. And get reversed again, depending on how the infection rates will come back.
And to go full circle from where we started, even in the states that are reopening, you're not seeing huge, I mean, you're seeing bumps, but nowhere near where you were at pre-recession levels in employment and things like, you know, restaurants and leisure and hospitality and travel. And even if the states don't shut down again, but the disease prevalence is increasing, demand from the populace will be lower for these types of activities. So you might be able to get, you know, people not going to some of those sectors, even if they don't shut down, and you'll see employment declines. So there's slow growth or declines as the disease continues to spread.
Yeah.
Mark, have you looked into any consumer data yet? Is there any real-time indication of activity, economic activity pulling back as a result of some of these hotspots really starting to flare up, Texas, California, Arizona, Florida?
It's a little early. All of the real-time data we look at that is at a regional level suggests, and this is like through really the end of last week coming into this week, it felt like things were still progressing reasonably well. I mean, a couple of things I noticed that struck me. One is that the states that reopened didn't really do much better than the states that had taken or were slower to reopen. They had a little bit of a head start, but not as much as you might anticipate. Maybe that goes to self-quarantining in those states that are reopening, or it's unclear to me, but there's not huge differences between the two. And the other thing is that, we are noted. I have started to notice in some of the business-to-business spending that's remained relatively weak. We saw a big bump up in consumer spending. Remember, in May we got that big May retail sales report, but that hasn't shown up in the B2B spending. So that suggests to me that a lot of the consumer spending came out of businesses' inventories. It wasn't an increase in production. Was more of an inventory drawdown, and that is evident in a lot of the regional data as well. So that's a couple things that have just struck me in the data, that it's the business reopenings aren't necessarily the supercharger that people might think it's going to be because of all the self-quarantining and other factors that go into, you know, deciding, you know, how fast to reopen, how much to reopen, and people going out and shopping to the degree that they, you know, want to shop.
I also wonder, Eric, as we have this conversation about different cities and different states, just what the long-term forecast is for cities and whether that changes. A lot of people I know that live in Manhattan are not coming back. They're looking in the suburbs right now. That's a real thing. So what's the forecast there, and how does that impact the demand for labor?
So you said an important thing. So they're in the suburbs now. The question is whether they will come back or not. So, you know, some of the work I have with other co-authors on more urban trends over the last, you know, 20 or so years has saw a tremendous amount of young people and, more importantly, high-educated young people flooding into cities. They're flooding into cities despite working in the suburbs. So if you take a city like San Francisco, they have, you know, a tremendous amount of reverse commuters, people who live in San Francisco and work abroad, you know, in the suburbs broadly defined. And so, you know, for me, I think the consumption part of cities will still come back in many dimensions, the restaurants and the movie theaters. There's the convention space that we talked about early on, whether people will do as much conventions. I still think they will do a lot of that. You know, as a person who loves Comic-Con himself, I still would travel. But so I don't think the young people will be disrupted from cities once the pandemic fades. How it affects commercial real estate and, you know, the office buildings and such, that's something that's going to be important. But I do believe that high-income people have been migrating to cities for, you know, a couple of decades now. And because cities offer luxury goods and amenities, and I still think those will be there. The production side of cities, I think that might be changing as well. But I'm going to predict your young, if you have young friends who are moving to the suburbs temporarily, they will come back when the pandemic has under control.
But I remember we had the same discussion post September 11, whether Manhattan, you know, people were leaving Manhattan. And in fact, recent years, the real estate prices really hit the rocket there. So I personally think that those who love living in the city, they will remain staying in the cities. I mean, it's going to take a couple of years. Memory has to be, washed, but it will come back.
Yeah, I don't think the consumption benefits of cities will change, but the production side will, and we might have some relocation.
Oh, yeah. I can tell you it's already happening in the commercial real estate market. I mean, big multinational corporations are significantly reevaluating their office space needs and acting on them already, giving back space in big urban cores all around the globe. So this work from home is less business travel. I think this work from home is the real deal and is going to significantly affect, you know, where people live and where they decide to work.
Yeah, can I just, so there's, you know, research from Nick Bloom and Steve Davis, one of Eric's colleagues, and the Federal Reserve Bank of Atlanta, that says that people expect the fraction of days spent working from home to triple after, that's business projections. And, I think although cities offer great consumption amenities, I think the main reason people have been moving to cities is, one, they've gotten safer, but two, that's where high-wage jobs are for the highly educated. Mm-hmm. And so you didn't have a choice previously.
Some of that is true, David, but I don't think you look at the reverse commuting patterns of young people, and you could actually see where they're choosing to live and work. You are seeing some differences.
I agree that there are benefits to cities, but my colleague David Mendel, who's a roboticist and historian, famously wrote that telepresence is a form of automation. Not being physically present. David said that in the context of developing telepresent underwater submarines for exploration, but we're going to be a lot more telepresent, and that telepresence is going to change where we think we need to be and how close cities. And there, I think there's a lot of people who might love cities, but also might like living in, you know, Colorado, you know, by the mountains. They didn't consider that an option. And now maybe they will. So I think it's
definitely going to be a reallocation. I think one thing that could be on the upside of this, though, is, you know, we'll call it the old days, February, when there was a huge amount of discussion about affordability issues in cities and the potential inequality effects of things like gentrification. And so if you have some corporate real estate needs moving out, that will have effects on land prices within cities, and the predominant beneficiaries of that, even holding amenities fixed for the restaurants and such, will be low-income individuals. And so, you know, so some of this effect could have positive effects on the income distribution through these reallocation channels.
Unless the jobs go with the business demand, right? So if the businesses are creating demand for cleaning and security and lunchtime meals and so on, so I agree the real estate prices will come down, but whether that will make cities better or worse for low-paid individuals depends a lot on the labor demand side as well as the housing price side.
I'm still conjecturing the consumption stuff's going to be there. So where a lot of those jobs are going to be, and they're going to lose the ad firms, which, again, there's going to be lower-wage workers in some of those ad firms, but I think disproportionately they'll be in the services. What I'm going to conjecture are going to stay.
The other factor that I think needs to be considered.
Playgrounds in Manhattan.
the other thing I throw into the mix that's going to affect the big urban cities is globalization, I think, will be meaningfully impaired by this event. That trade, immigration, foreign investment, these things are already on their back heels, you know, because of the financial crisis. You know, manifest in Brexit, manifested in the skepticism around globalization and current policy. That's all going to be exacerbated by what's going on there. We've got figurative border walls going up all over the world to protect themselves, everyone from the pandemic. And getting those walls back down is not going to be easy, and it's going to come down in a very different way. So we're not going to see, you know, the globalization come back, and these big urban centers like New York and Chicago and Miami and San Francisco, they're all going to be struggling with that for a considerable period of time.
We only have a few minutes left, but I think that takes us to a great final spot. And David, I think you're in a good position just coming off of that globalization to answer. What else should we be thinking about in terms of the permanent impacts of this, the structural impacts of how this pandemic, this crisis that we're still in, is going to affect the labor market and the way we think about jobs?
Great. Let me just make 2 points so I don't use up too much airtime. One is there's going to be a reallocation of employment from smaller to larger firms, just because, you know, many small firms will not make it through the kind of valley of death that we're in right now. And that actually has aggregate labor market implications, because larger firms are more capital intensive and less labor intensive. So labor's share of national income has fallen substantially since 2000, meaning more is being paid to profits and capital and less to workers. And a big part of that is the reallocation of economic activity from small firms, which are labor intensive, to large firms that are capital intensive. This will accelerate that process. So one thing it will do, it will redivide the pie towards owners of capital, away from owners of labor. Of course, owners of capital are much more concentrated. Hopefully everyone only owns one piece of labor, their own. Not everyone, most people don't own capital. The second thing that we want to think about is this structural change that I was speaking about earlier, and whether, you know, which sectors will come back and which ones will not. And that I don't think we know about much yet, but I think, oh, I'm sorry, I apologize. Here's the second point I actually want to make. Many of my colleague Jerome Acemoglu and others have argued that this will be kind of an automation forcing event. That there was a lot of kind of technologies on the shelf having to do with artificial intelligence, with robotics, with sensing, and just with reorganization to use less labor. And firms have had to learn those things very quickly because they've had, you know, a mandatory labor shortage. And once they learn those lessons, they won't unlearn those lessons. If they figure out how they can use their, do their production line with one third fewer workers, they will continue to do that. So you can argue that this pulled into the present things that would have taken many more years to discover. And so I think it will be a discrete jump, bump forward in the degree to which we rely less on in-person, more on online, more on automated services. That will have, you know, economic benefits, but it will cause labor market adjustment that's painful, for sure. Took too much air time, but thank you so much. Thank you. It's been a pleasure.
And Dana, what's going to happen is, let's just remember, the labor market was the tightest, right, pre-pandemic. And I think, yes, this automation, because of the social distance, is going to even further speed up. But I think the low-skilled workers recession will continue. The recession is not over for them unless we really upskill, reskill, which we know it's going to take years. So recession, again, from an inequality perspective, will stay for some.
Can I just throw one final quick and dirty out there for everyone, which is if we're lucky enough by ADP to be invited back next year, June 25th, 2021, what will the unemployment rate be in this country? Mark?
I think it'll be still around nine, high single digits, you know, 8, 9, 10%. A lot does depend on when we get that vaccine. So it might, you know, a prudent planner would say, okay, by this time that we get the vaccine. But even then, I think we're still in the high single digits. Are you writing this down, Sarah? You should write this down. You should write down these predictions.
Someone's writing them down.
Okay,
Mark.
Very good.
I am writing.
Okay, if we're writing them down, here it is. 8.8%. That's my number. 8.8%.
Okay. Yeah. Eric, what about you?
8.81.
Jeez.
So I thought it was like perfect, right? So I have a prediction. There's a public health component to this, and until the public health component gets solved, I don't know how to think about things.
But can I just slightly correct the question? So rather than the unemployment, I want to talk about labor force participation rate, which is
better. Yeah.
And I think one thing that could happen is that we're going to see a wave of retirements. I think there are going to be a lot of older workers who like have been out of work and they're like, well, this looks kind of risky. I'm going to go on Social Security a bit earlier. And so the labor force participation rate, the fraction of the population of working age who are working, will come down. So even when the unemployment rate drops, we will not have as large a fraction of people working as we would have.
Tara, I will just look at the data and I will let you know next year. I'll have the data. By the way, you will be invited. Smart, you have my promise here live.
Well, thank you. And thanks to the panelists. Thanks to ADP Research Institute. This was a fantastic discussion. And thanks to everyone in the audience for joining us too.